training class.
Yeah.
Good morning, Trinity family. It is great to be back with you this morning, back from the cold, cold mountains of West Virginia where I was last week, and it snowed all day on Saturday. So I'm happy to be back in the South, more South anyway. And this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Amen. Let's stand and sing Hosanna, praise is rising.
Rising, eyes are turning to you.
to our feet. Father, we come to worship and praise you today. Thy word.
In praise and thanksgiving. We come as those who know that you are the one that orders our steps, that gives us the word made flesh. You are the one that comes and communes with us and teaches us how to live our lives. We come to worship you. We come to praise you. And we do this all in the holy name of Jesus. And all the people say, amen. I invite you to say good morning to the people around you. It's a little bit further away. And to celebrate the Barnwells who have a new grandbaby. That's a neat thing. And the kids, come on down. All right, I brought some things with me today. These are all serving things, but they have different applications. Okay, what is this? Is it a hairbrush? Is it a toothpicker? What is it? A spaghetti spoon. Yeah, and it's a spaghetti spoon because it has these little claws on it, and it can pick up the spaghetti. Now, it's different than this one. This is also a spoon. It's just a regular spoon, but is it regular or does it have holes in it? It's a slotted spoon. Now, if I do baked beans, I can scoop them out with this, but the beans get mutilated because they get cut, right? Right? So it's different than this one. And this one, if I do baked beans, the juice can come out, so the beans are good. But this one, you put spaghetti with it, it falls all out. So it doesn't work, right? So those are different things. How about this? This has holes in it, too. It's a spiral. It holds. So what do we use this for? Like eggs and stuff. Flip stuff over with it. What else do we do with it? Your mom doesn't ever use it to whip your butt, does she?
No.
That's the wooden spoon. I got it. That's the one I used to get. All right, and these are tongs, and these are good. These can flip things over, too, but they're not quite as good as that. They pick things up. They can pick spaghetti up, but they're not as good as this, right? So each thing has a different use, but they all have something in common. What do? They serve food. They help to serve food. Okay. Did you know that you're called to be a spatula or a spaghetti spoon? Yeah? So what is that? What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that we're all called to serve, right? We're all called to serve. So what are some of the ways that you can serve God? Telling other people about him. Telling them what you're doing at church. Telling them some of the good things. Yes. Reading the Bible. Are you serving God by reading the Bible? Or are you learning about God by reading the Bible? Learning, yeah. So what are some other ways? Actually, intercessory prayer. You say that word with me. Intercessory prayer. Which means that you're not praying for yourself. Who are you praying for? No, you're praying for other people. Good job. Good job, other people. So when we intercede for people, we pray for them. If somebody's sick, somebody at school's having a hard time, what's another way that we can serve God? Kind of gave you a hint in the last thing. Maybe help your friends, help your parents. What are some things you can do to help your parents?
Do wood with your dad.
He makes you clean it up, right? Do chores. How about your neighbors? What's some of the things you can do for your neighbors? How about pick up sticks in their yard because they're older and they're like me and they hurt when they pick up sticks? Yeah, pond cones for your poppy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can bake them something to tell them you love them. All right, how about what you did last week? What did you do last week? You forgot. No, that was a couple weeks. They like the pretzel thing, all right? So what you did last week is you started a mission for kids who didn't have sports equipment.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And so today we're going to be talking about almsgiving, doing and serving things for God. So alms can be either giving money or giving a service or doing something for God. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. And so it's all the ways that we can serve God. Now, I know one other way is you guys serve the church, and it's on a video, and we're going to get to see it today. Isn't that cool? So that's one of the ways. We also know Cameron has sung for the church. Are you guys in the children's choir? Yes, so you have sung for the church. So those are the ways that you serve God. So there's a lot of different ways to serve God. So it says in the scriptures that we are to do all things as if we're doing it unto God for the glory of God. Isn't that cool? Why don't y'all sit up here and let's take a look at that video so we can see what it looks like to serve.
This morning, saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you.
Our scripture this morning comes from Matthew 6. We've been looking at the different disciplines that we need to follow in order to be disciples of Jesus Christ. And today we've gotten into the one that we would call acts of piety or service. So our scripture comes from Matthew 6, 1 through 4. I invite you to read that along with me. Beware of practicing your piety, acts of righteousness, before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, acts of righteousness, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your right hand know what your left hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees them in secret will reward you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Father, we come before you this morning, and we just ask that you would be with us, that you would speak to us, that you would show us what it means to be those who serve. Do acts of righteousness in your world. Father, we know that can take on many different forms and look like many different things. But we know the most important thing is the motive that we serve with. So today, as we hear your word, help us to hear the truth of what you're saying. And we pray this in Jesus' name, and all the people say, amen. There once was this famous violinist, and he was world-renowned, and he got the awesome privilege of serving and being able to play in Carnegie. And so he was so excited, and as he began to prepare, he made sure he had all his notes right and everything was running beautiful. So as he began to play, the music was wonderful, and as he lifted his string off the final note, the crowd went wild. They all stood up, they gave him a wonderful ovation, and he just smiled and he walked off the stage. Well, they wanted an encore, so they kept cheering him on, and he came back out and he did it again, and he just smiled and he walked off the stage. He did it a third time and a fourth time, and finally the fifth time, he played so flawlessly, everybody was breathless. Within a moment, the crowd stood up and they all applauded. He nodded his head and he walked off the stage. Well, the reporters were amazed because this guy usually did one encore at most, but he had done five encores. And one of the people that were trying to get a news report knocked on his door in his dressing room and said, can I have a moment with you? He said, sure. He says, we don't understand. You know, you could have stopped at the first encore. Your music was so wonderful and everything. Why did you keep going? And he said, well, I kept going because on the first encore, everybody stood but one man. And on the second encore, everybody stood but one man. And on the third encore, I saw how the crowd was crying and weeping, and everybody stood but one man. You see, this is the first night that my master has ever been with me. It's the first night that he's ever been at one of my concerts. And it was not until the fifth time I played that he stood. The question today is, who do we play for? Who do we serve for? Do we serve for our master, or do we serve for the crowds? We are called to live in a place where we are God pleasers. What is your life focused on? Is it the praises of men? Are you striving to please yourself, or are you being like Jesus and being a master pleaser? The Jews believed there were three major works in which God praised. They were almsgiving or serving. Acts of righteousness is another way of knowing that. Prayer, which we talked about a couple of weeks ago, and fasting, which we talked about 2 weeks ago. Jesus would not for a minute dispute that these acts of righteousness were important. In the Jews, the service of almsgiving was considered the most sacred because all the other things were regulatory, but this was something beyond that you did with your heart. There was a great rabbinic saying that says, "Greater is he who gives alms than who gives all the sacrifices." Remembering that alms is giving over and above the tithe, it can be financial, it can be service, it can be acts of righteousness. So what was troubling Jesus in this text? The religious folks were doing it for the wrong motive. They were trying to please the crowd. They were trying to get praise for themselves. With what motive do you serve the Lord? Are you a God pleaser, a people pleaser? What is your master? Who is your master? What calls you forward? Jesus says, be careful not to practice your righteousness, your righteous acts, your almsgiving, in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. Jesus warns us that these acts of righteousness need to be done with the right motive. One time or one way we give alms is to not really help others, but so that others might like us. Another way that we might serve is to demonstrate our generosity. Another way we might serve might be those who pray or look like we're holy, so other people will think we're holy. In each one of these, we find that even with fasting or prayer, reading scripture, if it's not done for the glory of God and it's done to increase our own popularity and prestige, then we're not serving or doing in the right for the right reason. If your aim is to get the world's reward, Jesus says, you will get nothing from God. Now, I know most of us are bred at birth to please. How many of you pleased your mom and your dad, right? If you get the A in school, then mom and dad are happy. Or if we do things that make other people happy, we are becoming people pleasers. We breed our children to be that way. We breed them to be people who look at community to see if they're doing okay. There's almost a comparative type of understanding in life. And it's because of that we find ourselves struggling with this thing of not caring what the world thinks, but only what God thinks. Jesus says we are to be father pleasers, not people pleasers. If you want to look that up, that's John 8:29. He cares about the motive in which we live our lives and in which we do our acts of service for him. We are to do all things as if they are unto the Lord. Why? Is it for God's benefit? No. Once again, as with tithing, it is for our benefit. It is so that we can be set free from the world's demands, so we can be set free from what we call prideful piety. It's so that we can know the free will of God and that we can know what it means to glorify him. In the Heidelberg Catechism, the first thing it says, we were created to glorify God. That's why you were created. Today, we focus on these acts of righteousness, these alms, these acts of service, in the right and the wrong way. That's what this text is all about. Jesus says, when you give to the needy, do not announce with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. What is he saying there? Don't blow your own horn. Do-do-do-do, look what I did. And don't be those who serve others in the way that you get the credit. Jesus assumes that we are going to serve. He says, when you serve. But this is the second time he is emphasizing where the heart is. It's the second time he tells us, and one of the things I know in Scripture, when they tell you and they tell you again, it means God means it. He's not just doing because it's easy. He does it because he means it. Acts of righteousness and service need not be for self-glorification, because then they become a hypocritical faith. It's a faith that is really says it's worshiping God, but who is it really worshiping? Self. It's worshiping self. In the older Greek, the word Hippocrates, or hypocrite, was an actor. It was someone who in the first century would wear a mask and pretend that they were someone else. By the time of the first century, it became an understanding of those who play roles in society as if the world was their stage. So what is Jesus saying here? Once again, Jesus is emphasizing that when we do something for others' applause, we are prostituting our faith. We are prostituting our righteousness. Now, I know under kingdom norms and me being up here, to share our faith visibly is something that we're called to do. We're called to do something. But we're called to do it for God's glory, not for the ostentatious praise of men. To trade the goal of being a father pleaser for the trivial, idolatrous goal of pleasing men will never do. And that's what the Pharisees were doing. And that's why Jesus says, truly I tell you, they've already received their reward. But when you give to the needy, he says, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. How can we do that so that we give in secret? To avoid the hypocrisy and not to cease giving and serving in secrecy. That we scarcely know what we've given, and yet at the same time, God gets the glory. I think that happens when we listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. When we listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit and we instantaneously do it, God protects us from that prideful understanding. So what motives lie behind our acts of service? I've got three that I know, and there's plenty more. One is those who give out of a sense of duty. Do you give your time? Do you give your service? Do you come to church? Do you pray? Do you do those things out of duty? AKA, as someone told me yesterday at a wedding, I'm doing that so I can get some kudos with God. They were serving me. They said, because you're God's servant, you know. And I said, that's not the way that works. Catherine Carswell talks about her daddy. Now, her daddy used to, during the early days in England, he would go and take a certain amount of pence, and he would release the men that were in prison that had gotten drunk during the night before. Because he knew that on Monday, if they didn't have a job, then they weren't going to be able to feed their kids. So he thought he was doing a very pious act. It was a good thing. The problem was, in his smugness, he would go, and in this duty, this sense of duty, he would give them a moral lecture, and he'd make them sign a piece of paper saying that they would pay him back with their next week's wages. He kind of saw himself as the champion, and he would make all the people in the community help him, and he'd make sure they knew that he did it. When someone gives out of a sense of duty or as a prideful pedestal or as a way to earn their living to heaven, that's not right. That's nothing more than what we would call giving because you feel that you have to out of a sense of duty. The second thing, some people give out of the motive of prestige and notoriety. There's a wonderful story about these people who were giving for a whole new branch in the zoo. And they were giving, it was in addition to one that was already there, and they were going to add another couple of acres into the zoo. And so they said, we'll do it on one condition. We get to have our plaque up at the beginning of the entrance. So everybody said, oh, sure, we can do that. Well, the problem was that the beginning of that particular section in the zoo had been given by somebody else. So what they did was they put their plaque on top of the others. Well, when they came and they saw that two people's plaques were up there, they were furious. They said, no, we're not going to give the money. And on top of that, we don't want our plaque on there. Sometimes people want all the glory and the prestige because of what they're doing. There's a problem with that, though. Does anybody remember Moses and what happened to him, why he couldn't go into the promised land? Anybody remember? He took God's glory. See, what happens when we take God's glory is we don't get to get into the promised land because we are taking away from God what is God's. We learned last week that Achan took from the tithe. And what happened to Achan? He got killed. So these are some of the things that we need to realize that we need to give with the right heart. And so finally, the right way to give is simply to listen to the Holy Spirit when we're prompted to do acts of righteousness, and we are to act on it instantly. Now, Blackaby says the reason why we need to do that is because partial obedience or delayed obedience is not true obedience. It means that we're trying to control it. So it's in that understanding that we come and we understand what God is saying. Coming home late one night, Mr. Johnson found himself in a precarious situation. He found a woman on the pavement, and she was in dire straits. He tried to talk to her, and she was so exhausted that she could hardly speak. So he picked her up, he put her on his back, and he carried her home, and he began to help her. As he began to help her, he fed her, he gave her water, he took care of her. And after a while, she came around. And when she came around, she began to talk to him, and he realized that she was a woman of ill repute. And it was all of a sudden in that place that he says, oh, what am I going to do? And God was very clear. He said, nurse her back to health. So he nursed her back to health, and after he did, when she was well, he got her a respectable job. And when he got her a respectable job, all of a sudden, she was living in a way that would be honored by God. Mr. Johnson got nothing in that exchange except for what? Praise from God and criticism from the neighbors. But blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness. You see, we have a perfect pattern in Jesus. Jesus gave his life. He acted on earth in acts of righteousness so that in his poverty we might become rich. Our giving should never be grim or self-serving, never out of the sense of duty, never done for our own glory, but serving so that God might be glorified as prompted by the Holy Spirit. What is your motive of serving? Why do you give to God? Why are you in a relationship with God? Are you a God pleaser like Jesus or a people pleaser? Are you seeking worldly success or to glorify God with your life? The great composer Johann Sebastian Bach once said, all music should have no end or aim except to glorify God and give the soul refreshment. Where this is not done, there is no real music, only devilish hubbub. We too should be those who allow our life to give God glory. As Bach ended each one of his beautiful works of music with SDG, which stands up for Sola de Grata, which means glory to God, we need to do the same with everything we do in our life. With everything, we need to glorify God. With each way we say, each way we act, and with all that we do is to be for the glory of God. I pray that you hear what God's word is to you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And all the people say, amen. Well, this morning we get the holy privilege of seeing the sacrifice that Jesus gave to us. We get to share communion together. And communion is the acts of service that God gives to us that we might know the sweet embrace of the Savior. So today we're going to be using table number 2 in your hymnal, page 12, and you'll also see it on the screen. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Did I mess up one? Okay. We have not loved our neighbors. That's an important one. Okay. Forgive us, we pray, and free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Father, we repent of those places where we have taken your glory, and we ask, Lord, that you would come today, that you would forgive us, and that you would bring us into joyful obedience in your kingdom. We hear the words of Jesus, the good news, that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Now, as forgiven and reconciled people, let us now serve communion. We're going to do it a little different today. We're going to invite you to come forward. We're going to give you your cup, and so you have a chance to kneel. We've had a couple of people. If you cannot come forward and you need someone to bring you the elements, just raise your hand and Bob will bring them to you. Dearly beloved, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all their company in heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, praying together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Yes, blessed are you and holy are you. And holy is your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, is by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection that you gave birth to your church, that you delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by the water and the Spirit. On the night in which the Lord Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he gave thanks to the Father, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body given for you." Likewise, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he said, "This is the blood of the covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of all sin. Take and drink, take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifices in union with Christ's offering for us as our lives proclaim that mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, O God, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we might be the body of Christ, redeemed by your blood, in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in that final victory and we feast at your heavenly banquet. We pray this through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, and your holy church. For all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore, and all the people say amen. I do have a few prayers that I want to lift up today before we do the Lord's Prayer. Bob, our sound booth guy back there, is going to be having heart surgery on Wednesday. If you would please keep Bob in prayer. He's going to get the mitral valve replaced. I know that Vernie has started his therapy, and so keep him and his heart in place. I know that there's others in our community who have been blessed with children. We have a couple that are grandparents and some that are foster, and we want to give God the glory for that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and lift up the names of those who need God's healing touch. Father, we come today and we thank you for the gift of children. We thank you that you have blessed us in more than one way. And we ask, Lord, that you continue to bless the families and bring these children up in the holy faith. Father, we also come as those who are excited that you have given opportunities to people in the ways of surgeries and new wonderful things. I pray, Father, for Walter Forrest today, who is awaiting a back surgery. We pray for Bob, and we ask, Lord, that you would bless him and bless his doctors as he awaits this heart surgery. And Father, we pray for Vernon as he continues in his therapy. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. And we ask, Lord, that you would continue to bless them and bless us as we in community continue to be the church. Father, I now offer up a time when all of us can lift up names in the name of Jesus. Robbie. Lord, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayers. And now, Father, we come and pray that prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. I invite you to come today as those who are coming to the altar of Jesus Christ. We'll have two stations. Vernon will be on this side. I'll be on this. Please come as the Lord leads you. If you cannot come up and you would like for Jimmy to bring you the elements, just raise your hand and he'll come bring them to you. Please come as the Spirit leads. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood rich of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For those online, this is the body broken for you. Take and eat. This is the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Take. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for this holy mystery and the way you reveal Jesus Christ. We thank you for the holy privilege that you use us, that you use us to be a revelation unto our world. Help us, Lord, to be all that you've called us to be, whether it's a spaghetti strainer, a flipper dodger, snarf flat, whatever it is, let us do it all for your glory. And we pray this in Jesus' holy name, and all the people say, amen. I do have a few announcements for you. If you are a visitor, we have a bag for you on the side. We'd love to give you one of those. And if you are a child, we have children's bags. I have one sign left. One sign left if you want to put it in your yard. That's the very last one. We have them all around town. I've been seeing them. I'm excited about that. We also have cards up here in the front for those to share with your neighbors and your friends about our Easter week service. You'll notice in the bulletin we have an insert. We have a new visitation pastor to help our current one. George is having a hard time getting out. He keeps falling, and He told me that he cannot get out anymore. He can phone, so you might get a phone call from him. But as far as visitations and going around to hospitals and for shut-ins, Carol's going to be taking that position. She and George will be serving together. Jordan McDougall will be our new church coordinator. As you know, Christina, sadly, is going on to greener pastures, she would say. She's going to go be with her mom and dad. She has gotten a job in a college near her home, and she will be serving there as an administrative assistant to the dean. She's excited about that because some of the things that she's just taken in her class will be able to be used. We will miss her greatly. I want to make sure that you know that we're going to have a Goodwill service for her on April 24th. I will get that out of my mouth. April 24th. I invite you to bring a card or a little gift, and we're just going to just shower her with that. You can give her a gift card. You don't have, just give her a card of appreciation so that she can know how much you love her and how grateful you are of her service. Also, you'll notice that the flowers today are given in memory of Greg Hopkins, and you know that is Gary's brother, and that's given by Dave and Debbie Creasy for his memories. We also are still doing goals for Ghana. You'll find the little containers out in the commons area. We also want to give a big congratulations. Everybody put your hands together for Rich and Beth Barnwell on the granddaughter birth. We will also celebrate next week another one, as we did have another one, and I'll put all that information in their bulletin because that happened later in the week. And I don't know if you know Brooks and Sheila, they also had a grandbaby, which is pretty exciting. So those are all the announcements I have. Are there any more from the body of Christ? Being no more, I say, let's sing.
Let's stand and sing. We know that we're surrounded by a lot of stuff in the world today, but we ask Jesus to surround us with him and his love and his truth. Surrounded.
Go forth this day in the glory of God, knowing that he created you, he calls you, he ordains you as the priesthood of all believers, And he calls you to shine his glory. Go forth in that glory in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Snarf black.